Thank you for joining me for the first of what I hope is an ongoing series of conversations where we can sit with creators and discuss their process and their approach to the visual interpretation of story. By using this platform, we'll be able to broadcast to anyone, anywhere, and we'll also be answering your questions. If you're watching us through Google+, you can use the Q&A feature located right in the viewing panel. You can also ask your questions directly to us using Twitter. A video of this broadcast will be made available on YouTube. Okay. Let me introduce our guest. By showing you some samples. Dominick Saponaro is an award-winning artist from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, working in the illustration field for over 10 years. His work has been featured in Spectrum, Exposé, Imagine Effects, and showcased in numerous galleries and illustration shows. Some clients include publishers of books, video games, and magazines such as Simon & Schuster, Tor Books, HarperCollins, Audible, the Science Fiction Book Club, and Solaris Books. Recently, Dominick's work was selected to be featured on the website for the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art. Dominick joins us from his studio in Philadelphia. Welcome, Dominick.
Hi. Hello, everybody. How's it going?
It's good to see you.
You as well.
I'm looking forward to chatting with you about your process, about your influences, about the industry of illustration, and how you are a part of it, and hopefully answer questions for people, you know, go through your process. I guess we should begin with your origins and your influences.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, well, go back to our slideshow here. And later on, we'll be discussing the four Destroyerman covers that you and I both worked on. You as the illustrator and I as the art director, and how a series like this is considered, and the thought process that goes into a series, knowing that you are going to be dealing with similar subject matter over the course of multiple editions, and how one needs to look different than the other yet maintain some continuity. But we'll begin with your influences first.
Okay. You want me to just run through them for you?
Yeah, I mean, these are some images that you sent me, so I would love if you could explain, tell us a little bit about the artists and you know, how you are attracted to them, and in some ways how you relate your work to these influences.
Okay, you know, I'll just run through the names first, and I'll talk a little bit how I got into them and what I sort of see in them. In the top left there, I've got Jean-Léon Gérôme. He's an Orientalist. I've got the next one over to the right is Howard Pyle, and then N.C. Wyeth, and the bottom is Sal Tepper. I'm completely blanking now on the middle one. Dean Cornwall on the right, and then I'm completely blanking on the name now. Med Schaefer. So basically, I was really throughout college, and certainly from the area I'm in, I was really attracted to all these Brandywine artists, which are the bottom row, and then obviously N.C. Wyeth and Howard Pyle as well. So they were really huge for me in college. And then, and certainly Jean-Leon Jerome was as well. And honestly, when I looked at Jerome's work back many, many years ago, to me, that was really just fantasy. And not sci-fi, but it was definitely fantasy to me, even though it was originally created more in historical context when it was painted. But, you know, the sample that I have here is just, you know, as soon as I saw that, I really just thought of all the, you know, the movies that I watched and sort of these fantasy epic influences growing up outside of art. And then, you know, it was just this sort of love of basically adventure stories for the most part. I think the Brandywine tradition certainly carried through with that as well. And then, you know, I think I look back at this stuff and I see sort of very masculine, powerful imagery, bold brushstrokes, certainly in the Golden Age illustrators. And as well, so, but yeah, and I guess if I had to pick one out of all these guys, I'd have to go with even though it's the smallest image here, Wyeth. He was my, I guess my ultimate hero. So,
you know, seeing this grouping together, for me, there's such similarities in that there's strong forms, but there's also great attention to lights and darks. In some instances, it's the lighting. In other instances, it's how the forms attach themselves to other forms. And then there's also great storytelling. You know, I'm seeing in all of these, there is something that makes you want to know more about what we're looking at and what is the story behind it. So it's interesting to see a grouping of pieces of art from people who you admire and are influences of yours, all having that same connection.
Yeah, it's funny looking at these now because I'm seeing things that I didn't really notice. I, at the time when I was looking at them, I didn't really know why I liked them. They were just powerful images. And I'm looking at, you know, even right now, I'm just looking at the bottom three, the black and whites. And I was just drawn to the dramatic lighting, basically, right. At least on the Med Schaefer and the Sal Tepper one, for sure. And the deep shadows on the eyes, you know, it's a very Wyeth Golden Age illustration sort of thing in a lot of his images. But I was really drawn to that sort of dramatic lighting, and also the black and white nature of the work, and not only these guys, but especially Howard Pyle, his grisailles, I just think are masterworks, honestly, and. I think you're going to, once we show my process shot, it actually kind of relates to that in that I was really drawn to black and white work, certainly growing up and in college, and I still respond to it really, pretty powerfully, actually. I just love the dramatic, range of values and the use of strong, value in.
Right. Well, they're also well designed shapes. I mean, the shapes themselves, it's not the characters necessarily, but especially, you know, that middle one on the bottom, it's so well designed. There's so much there, and yet everything is just working so nicely together without it one side fighting the other side. There's atmosphere, there's setting, there's something happening behind them, there's the main focus. So there's that as well on these.
Yeah, no, I love this stuff. I mean, I still, you know, I still look at, you know, I still look at them constantly. I've got, you know, hundreds of books of all these guys, and I still go back to these guys for pretty much every project I work on in some way or another. So.
Okay, so this was, you told me earlier that you sent me influences, how did you put it? You had some contemporary influences and some...
Okay, so So this slide is basically the Golden Age illustrators, and then even before that, so sort of old school influences. And then the next slide you have, which should be coming up, is more contemporary, so more modern age guys. So we've got Frank Frazetta on the left,
right?
Who probably this image in particular is the one image that got me honestly even thinking about illustration at all. I had my brother had a record, and it was I don't know if the camera can see it, but behind me there's the original record that my brother had, and it was Molly Hatchet, and they're not a good band necessarily, but the imagery was amazing, and I saw that when I was probably 8 years old or so. And I was blown away by it. I just think it's it really kind of captured my imagination, and I probably drew this thing hundreds of times just copying the record, and I just love the image. So that really got me into Frank Frazetta's work, and then moving even more modern contemporary, we come up to James Gurney in the middle there, top. Mike Mignola on the right there, and then of course Greg Manchez on the bottom right. So, for James Gurney's work, I had Dinotopia back in college. I was I think the second or third book was coming out right when I was in a junior or senior in college, and I just loved James Gurney's work, his specifically his palettes. I was really blown away. And I struggled with color throughout school, and I really looked to his work a lot for ideas on color and things he was doing with palettes and mood and things like that. And then we have Mike Mignola, who I enjoyed in college, but I would say in the past 10 years or so, I've really gotten back into him a lot more, and I think he's brilliant. I mean, his sense of design with his simplified forms, I think, is outstanding. Right. And then going back to the sort of that deep, dark, heavy shadows again from the Golden Age guys, I think it really kind of relates in that way. The other thing I love about Mike's work is the simplicity. It's simplistic design, and one thing I've learned over the years is just that, that's some of the hardest things to do, is to simplify your image making down to its bare essentials. And I think he's just phenomenal at that.
Would you say, I know you want to get to Greg's work as well, but would you say looking at these, I know Dinotopia, was it the art that attracted you to James Gurney's work? Mignola, were you interested in Mignola reading it for the story, for the storyline for Hellboy? I mean,
initially it was just the visuals on both Gurney and Mike. But I've learned to, I mean, now I mean, Mike's Hellboys and BPRD and pretty much anything that he has his hand in, I think is really well written. And I enjoy his storytelling now. But when I first got into it and really kind of struck me, it was definitely just for the imagery. Same with James Gurney's work. I bought it, for the pictures, and then I've learned to really appreciate the storytelling. Mm-hmm. The one thing that James Gurney book, the second one, that the image here is that I put in here. The second book I really kind of found fascinating, because if anybody's familiar with it, you go from beginning to end of that book, and it's the palettes in it he uses dictate the time of day, and it kind of has a time frame that's dictated through the use of color, and he uses that to advance the story not only in a sort of timely manner, but for narrative purposes as well.
So you're speaking about A World Beneath, the second book of Dinotopia?
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. And I think all his books are brilliant, but for some reason that second one, I think it came out just the right time for me when I was struggling with color, and then I saw what he was doing with it to sort of push the narrative forward just through his palettes. And that really kind of struck me as really kind of cool at the time. So
I guess it's no mistake then that, you know, he recently published a book called Color and Light that really goes through some tips and techniques and his own experiences of what artists struggle with when it comes to color.
Oh yeah, those books are great. Yeah, Color and Light and Imaginative Realism. I just think, you know, what I wouldn't have given to have those 20 years ago. You know,
yeah, everyone is saying that.
But I think James Gurney's pretty amazing. And then the final one I have there is Greg Manchez. And the thing that got me with Greg, again, all these kind of go back to when I was in school. Our senior year, we had a gallery in our illustration department at the University of the Arts. And three times a semester, we would get three different artists in for the year. And Greg happened to come in, I believe it was right around my junior year in college. And at the time, as much as I liked all of these Brandywine artists and these classic artists like Wyeth, Pyle, etc., I didn't really see how I could do that in a contemporary sort of illustration fashion. And then when I saw Greg's work on the wall, it kind of blew my mind because I was like, this is it. This is age illustration in a certain sense. At least the images that he was creating kind of at least struck a chord with me, and they harken back to, you know, the N.C. Wyeth, the Sal Tepper, Dean Cornwell. And I kind of saw that, oh, wait, you know, I can do these sort of, at the time anyway, sort of old type of imagery, I guess you could sort of call it, but you still could do it in a contemporary sort of fashion and with a contemporary sensibility to it. So that was really kind of eye-opening in a sense. So
it's also interesting.
It's also interesting looking at this.
Looking at this. This selection of contemporary
influence.
That your at least two of them.
At least two of them.
How James Gurney has definitely been influenced by Howard Pyle, and he's done a lot of. He has done quite a bit of. I think he had a lecture on Howard Pyle. I know Greg Manchez is someone who
admires the Golden
Globes. Well, so it's a nice
slide.
Sure. Yeah, I'm sure all these guys looked at their predecessors for certain. I'm sure even Wyeth and Pyle were looking at Jerome, or if not specifically Jerome, someone with similar sort of qualities or sensibilities. You can definitely see, I think, some connections and that these different guys were looking. I mean, I know Frank Frazetta was looking at Wyeth quite a bit and so on. So I think they all, I think everybody's looking back, you know, to see what was done before, you know. So.
Okay, so
I know.
You have Dominick.
Echoing there.
No, you sound all right. The audio is a little funky, but it's not too bad.
So I thought we would.
About your process.
Okay.
We could.
So right now,
I'm on the first slide.
I've done this on other occasions
and gone through your process.
You're kind of cutting out on me, Matt.
Okay. Any better?
There you go.
So I was just turning it over to you in a little conversation about your process. You work digitally.
Yes.
But you definitely employ a very traditional
Yeah, and I'll talk about that as you go through the slides if you want. You know, as much as I work with some high-tech software and hardware, you know, it's I really work in a pretty darn low-tech manner, meaning which I think you'll probably see when once it comes to the once it comes to the actual painting stage of the work, for the most part, I think you're going to see I work in a really traditional sort of sense. So, but we can go through them if you want to start with the thumbnails. So.
Okay, so we're looking at thumbnails.
Thumbnails.
Okay, so this was done for actually it was a project for Nightshade Books. It was a bit of a sort of supernatural feel, ghost hunters type of story. There's 1, 2, 3. There's 10 of them here. I probably do more than I forget this particular job specifically, but there's probably a lot more than this that I did for myself. There's certainly some rougher ones before I clean them up and send them off. I get a lot of response out of my thumbnails, in that they're detailed, and I always kind of I don't know if I agree with that they're detailed in a certain sense. Meaning, if you really look at a lot of them, they're really kind of blobby, and you know, the anatomy's off, and things like that. I think I get across a nice sense of value, which I'm really shooting for. Which, you know, I spoke a little bit about with my influences, meaning their strong sense of values. I really try to get that early on in the early stages. So if you want to go to the next one, we can talk about a couple more.
I'm being told that there's a lot of echo. I'm not sure why.
Okay. Okay, so these are thumbnails for Tom posted a question for me, which we can cover in the Q&A, but I think everybody can see the questions now. But this was for Tom's American Craftsman for tour books. It's kind of a Tinker Tailor, Soldier Spy meets old world magic, so to speak, with a little bit of, I would say, sort of Call of Duty in there in terms of action here and there and things like that. And it was a lot of fun. But the one thing I want to talk about my thumbnails, I think, is I never used to do them to this level of finish. I really, you know, I spent many, many years doing extremely rough thumbnails, and I would probably say that they really didn't do anything for me, and I know darn well that they didn't do anything for the client in terms of getting the idea across. It was kind of just a stage that I thought I had to go through, and I would send them off, and the response that I would always get is like, well, you know, send me the sketch, the drawing, the next stage, basically. and I did that because I just really hated doing thumbnails, honestly, for you know, when I was in school on through to many years when I was working after school, until one day I kind of sat down, And I really forced myself to, instead of approaching it as a thumbnail, to really approach it as a mini little painting. If you want to go to the next one, you can jump on and continue.
Sure. Sure.
This is for the second in the series for tour again. The title's The Left-Hand Way, and I think we have I'm not sure if we have samples of the finals in the slideshow, but people can see it on my website if they're interested. But I really kind of turned in crummy thumbnails for years, and again, I didn't get anything out of them for myself, so I would sort of just find everything out at the next stage. And I forced myself to sit down and basically create little mini paintings instead of thinking of them as thumbnails. And what I found started to happen was, first off, the clients really responded to it, which I didn't really expect. But it was nice that it happened. The other thing about it was that I started to see in a very short time my composition skills basically grow in that up until I started doing sort of the rendered thumbnails, I was doing very basic, simple compositions, one figure, two figures at the most. My compositional overlap was really kind of funky, and I was avoiding strange areas, uncomfortable areas, and not sort of tackling the problems. And once I started to force myself to approach the thumbnails as full-blown paintings, at least in a very small sort of fashion, I really started to be more confident with my composition. And I found composition is one of the hardest things to learn. I know, you know, when I teach, I try to teach my students about it, and it's, you know, there's, you know, a lot like everything else, the only way you're going to get better at it is by practicing it and practicing composition. The most economical, efficient way to do that, I really think, is through sketching or thumbnail sketching, just because you can do a lot. And even if they're similar compositions like this one, you know, it's little tweaks here and there that I move elements around and so on and see what overlaps and what value structure sort of works well and so on. So, you know, it's all about really perfecting the composition at this stage for me, you know, so.
I remember, I don't know, I'm hoping that the echo is better.
Better.
You can weigh in. I've
got two-way
headset instead.
Okay. Sounds pretty good on my end.
Okay. So,
I'm really pleased with the first thumbnail, and I know that you don't detail, but it was very clear to make my selection, communicate it to members of the team that are not as visual.
And it really helped the process. It really helped the process to get things approved and visualize it and move forward. There have been instances in my career where there were lots of requests down the line, unfortunately, because things were not clear earlier on.
Okay. Yeah, it's pretty great because I have gotten for the most part a lot of a positive response for them. Although I will say in more recent in the past year or so, I've toned it down a bit in terms of the number. I think, and also I change it up depending on the client because I've learned that some clients prefer a lot of choices like yourself, and then there's others that, you know, it wrangling it into three or four is probably the best. And that's something I think I learn on a client by client basis, honestly. But it's really the most important thing to it is that it really, it's taught me so much about composition, honestly. So, but it's, and the other end too, is I don't load thumbnails anymore, which I've kind of found them to be sort of enjoyable, certainly much more than they were in the past. So,
well, I know that there are, you know, Dominick, I don't know, Dominick, if you, I don't know, if down your volume, down your volume, it might be part of it.
I turned it down a little bit. You want me to try the headphones, see if that works?
Some people are saying that works.
All right. Well, I got them here. If you think I should try it, but I've got you down pretty low, so I don't know if how much the volume's affecting.
Yeah, I've lowered yours as well. I hear you, but more importantly, I'm not distracted by my own voice. But I think everyone's hearing the echo.
There are certain steps in the process that an illustrator takes that may seem time consuming, but in the long run, saving you time and giving you something that will enable you to be much more on point.
You were not going down what seems like long racks. When it comes to
when it comes to building models,
that these things will eventually give you something that's much more perfect for work. I think it's a good point that Adobe thumbnails. I include your thumbnails in my for exactly that purpose.
Yeah, you know, that's another good point, actually. Another thing that I forgot about was the fact that also doing this, as much as it might take me a decent amount of time to get these done, in the long run, it really does save me time in the it shaves off time from the overall project, meaning in the past when I was doing them so rough that I didn't really have a clear idea where I was heading once I moved to a final drawing stage, it would just take me that much longer to do that drawing because I didn't really have a clear idea where I was going. I was kind of finding it out on the canvas, so to speak. And as much as and this is something I try to get across to students all the time, is that it's something I use in a lecture. It's basically prep work pays off in dividends, meaning that, you know, if you put the work in early on the sketch stage, you might think, you know, you might be eager to jump ahead to the final. But if you do the work early, figure out where your values are and things like that, it's going to make that painting so much easier and less time consuming, honestly. And that's not to say you don't have room to tweak once you move from thumbnails to just drawing or drawing to final and things like that. You can certainly tweak some things and change them around a little bit if it works better, and I usually do. But it's just, believe it or not, there's those shortcuts, trying not to do a certain part of the project, things like that, or kind of skip ahead to the next stage. It really, you know, I've learned over the years now that there aren't any shortcuts for it, unfortunately, so at least for when I'm working, I find it. So
I know you. I know you. Lots of reference and research. So why don't we look at them quickly here?
Sure. This is just a quick shot overview of many different references through the years, and it's really just to show or to illustrate the fact that I use all different types of objects, costumes, people. I tend to use myself a lot just because I'm very cheap in terms of being a model, but I'm readily available, and it's not because I like to see myself in these poses and ridiculous costumes, but it's I think it's cool to see the wide selection of different costumes and elements, like the models, the boats at a museum, the ships head pieces from a museum, et cetera, and things like that. So okay, and then so the next stage is the final drawing, and then the full value black and white underpainting, which I mentioned briefly about the idea that while I work digitally, my actual technique is a very traditional technique, and I sort of paint digitally exactly how I painted traditionally, meaning that I did when I worked in oils for years in college and afterwards, I did an underpainting with burnt umber, and then I would just overpaint with full value color, et cetera. So I lock the values in with the umber and then move on. Once I started to work digitally, honestly, I did it kind of mostly out of, I guess you'd say, ignorance, in that I kind of just assumed that I would paint the same way. So my first stage is just to do a very quick drawing. It's not anything beautiful. It's just a guideline for me to start laying down value and shadow and light. It's not a type of drawing that I would hang on my wall, but it's a blueprint to start laying in the paint. So if you go to the next one. And then, so for the next stage, what I do in Photoshop, I'll basically just sort of tone the canvas with a paint bucket of a darker to a middle ground tone. make sure it's transparent. Now I either do that through just dropping the opacity on the layers or by changing the blending mode, which can just let that pencil show through, and that's kind of the key to me. So I can just see that initial guide that I put down. And then from here, so the last slide and then this slide, I'm basically what I'm doing is just pulling out the lights with an eraser. And that's it. It's not, you know, I get a lot of questions about my brushes and what do I use. And I don't really use anything too fancy. It's just a soft edge eraser tool in Photoshop. And I'm just pulling out that darker layer that's knocked back opacity-wise. So if you go to the next one. And then this is just further along, but still the same thing. Up until this point, there is nothing other than an eraser being used to pull out the darks of the highlights of the face here. And
so you're purely working it out.
Yeah, and that's it, just black and white. And that's I kind of developed this because I really struggled with color, which we can talk about with the color study stages. But for this stage, so you notice at that slide, the marks are looking a little bit different there. And that's because at this point, I once I lock in all the values with just the eraser, pulling out the lights, I'll jump over to Corel Painter at this point. And then I start putting in my kind of brushier, chunkier mark making. I guess I'm pushing the value further, but more so, most of that value is already there from that erasing out. And now I'm just sort of reinforcing the planes of light and shadow with a more opaque, I guess you could say, brush. And I would sort of equate this to back when I worked in oils, where I would start putting down the thicker paint. And I'm sort of working in a very thin to thick manner, much like oil paints. And that the shadows that are showing through are going to just be that sort of digital underpainting, which is used the eraser and the soft edges from the beginning. And so I don't go too much into the shadows with opaque brushes. It's more letting that thin layer show through, and then the more opaque I get goes towards the highlights, if that makes sense. So. And then, so this next slide is basically more of the same. It's just adding more opaques on top of it. But again, if you look into the shadows of the eyes, that's just the initial underpainting transparent layer showing through. And then, so I developed up the bottom neck, the shirt and the bow tie. And then I go to the next slide, and it's, I toned it down a little bit here, and that's just using basically a simple sort of airbrush in either Photoshop or Corel Painter. Honestly, at this point, I jump back and forth between the two programs, and I blocked in the background here. But again, it's just kind of now I'm just adjusting it because I've kind of got it right about where I want to go for the piece, and then for the next slide, I just adjust the background, because at first I was thinking I wanted the face to come out of the shadow, which I did, but I kind of saw an opportunity to sort of reinforce that focal area by having the face come out of the shadow, which is the hair, but then having the hair pop off the background and giving a really nice silhouette to the figure of the flag behind it. So then up until this point, I basically worked only in black and white, and I basically create a full-blown painting that is black and white in terms of all the detail, brush marks, texture, things like that. And I honestly try to not think about color for as long as possible, honestly, because to me, really, the most important thing is getting the lights and darks down on an image. And it's whether it's a simple portrait like this or a really complex image, it's all about the lights and darks, not necessarily whether that's the right color green, whether that green is a little too blue or a little too yellow. It's all about whether that green is too light or dark. And back when I was in college, I really struggled so much with it that, you know, that really intense saturated color of, let's say, a red sweater would kind of throw me for a loop. And my perception of intense saturations and bright colors really, you know, kind of confused me. And I kind of worked on this method, finding a way in order to just focus on lights and darks first, and then I kind of add the color on top of it. So if you go to the next stage.
Yeah, I wanted to.
Sure.
To number one, ask
number one, ask
you want to try putting I think if we both do it,
both do it,
that'd be echo.
Sure.
And then I
and then we're getting about.
I'll give you a second.
How's that sound?
Well, it sounds good to me, and everybody will weigh in, I'm sure, and tell me if the problem with the echo has been fixed. We are getting a question. Rachel's asking about if you ever feel that having a strong grayscale image, sometimes the impact of colors is harder to come across when coloring digitally. And I know that you have this next set of slides will address some of the color issues, but I wanted to read her question to you.
Hi, Rachel. How's it going? Rachel is one of my students.
Okay.
Just read through this question one more time. Such a strong grayscale image. In regards to that question, no, I don't. I think that the strong grayscale image actually helps me. It just reinforces the lighting of the scene, and I think you can see, at least in this example, for instance, the color studies. I can paint this painting any different palette, but as long as the lights and darks are there, it still works. Now, a lot of these color studies that are up are they're not drastically different palettes, but if you remember the older thumbnails that I had up that we showed, there were some pretty drastic color palettes. So for instance, in the Destroyer Men covers, there was a green cover, a red cover, and so on. And they all work to a certain extent. Some, you know, I think we prefer better than others, but it's really about the lights and darks. And honestly, that just reinforces that for me. It makes it the color much stronger to me, I guess you could say. So, in this case, I basically took the black and white and just shrunk it down real small, and then just started painting on top through a color layer mode, which is in Photoshop. There's a blending modes, and what that allows is that it allows me to basically change the hue and saturation of the image without changing the value, because I put all that work into the black and white. I don't want to lose that once I start laying down, you know, red, green, blue, or whatever color scheme I want to. So, all right.
By the way, our echo problem has been fixed.
Excellent. Good.
Okay. So I know that in Destroyer Men as well, you mentioned it just a second ago, that color was a consideration. We'll talk about that when we're looking at Destroyer Men. But I think we were doing that in a way. Our initial conversations were that the Destroyer Men books were going to be lots of water. It was naval battles, and we were going to be faced with the possibility of many covers that were lots of blues. So we were trying to vary that for the sake of not producing the same type of cover every single time.
Yes. Well, we can also talk about that once we show the Destroyer Men covers too.
Right.
So,
all right, I'm waiting for the next slide.
Okay, so in the process, this again is just a repeat of the other slide, so we can move to the next one. But this is basically the black and white final with all the texture, brush marks in, lights, darks. It's essentially a painting that's finished without the color information in there. And then what I do from there, at least for this particular image, I turned it to a sepia tone in order to sort of give it, because I knew with the color studies that I was going for, I liked the ones that kind of resembled essentially an old time photograph to a certain extent. And so I just kind of adjusted the tones on it to make it a sepia tone, and then I created a new layer on top of that, and then just essentially at this stage color it in almost like in a coloring book fashion, And it kind of looks like a big jump if you go from the sepia tone to this, and you go, oh, wait a minute, how'd you, it's, you're not showing me all the tricks in here and how you got it to here, but it's really, it's almost as if I'm approaching it like a coloring book, and picking, you know, for instance, the skin tone. And if I just paint over a color layer, that skin tone's going to stay there. But the light and dark of the skin tone isn't going to change. And then I put in the blue and then the red in the background. And then from there, I slowly get more detailed with my color choices, meaning in the forehead, for instance, maybe add a little bit of red or yellow to adjust the hues of it. So it doesn't just look like a colorized photo, and getting more detailed with the color choices. So, and then when you go to I think this is the final slide. The key to it from there is, after I colorize it, so to speak, I can't leave it just colorized, because what it ends up looking like is a colorized photo almost, or not a photo, but a colorized painting instead of just a full-blown painting. And then I have to go back in and tweak some of the values and colors and paint a little bit more opaquely on top of it. So
that could be sort of the question that Rachel was asking about how to still have a vibrant color when your process is the type that begins with such a value focused composition. It's good to know that you don't just leave it there, that you actually start to go in and paint on top of it once you've made your color decisions.
Yeah, there's always tweaking at the end, because for instance, maybe the value of Lincoln's head looks perfect in black and white. Once I start putting down certain colors there, it usually takes a little bit of just adjusting, so to speak, because the values that are there aren't going to look perfect with the exact color and things like that. So, but it's generally, for the most part, those values stay exactly where I had them in the black and white, and it shifts very little. And it's again, it's a, you know, it's something I started to do just because I you know, if I was to paint that red behind the ear, I would think it was, if I was just to pick that red right from Photoshop, I would probably immediately think it's much brighter red than it really is, and so on. It's kind of that basic concept that really threw me for a loop, which kind of led me to this kind of painting in all black and white and then colorizing it, so to speak. One other note about it, actually, though, the whole painting process, up until the color, I think a lot of people think that the color takes a while, and it really doesn't. It's the majority of the work. Well, first off, the majority of the work goes into the thumbnails and development of the composition and things like that. But the meat of the painting process, 95% of it is that black and white painting. And then the coloring part is kind of the last 5%, I would say, and then tweaks and adjustments and so on. So
I'd like to add that this also is not, it's not a new thing per se. I remember hearing in art history classes that for economy reasons, that artists would work in a grayscale. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about before the printing age, before the golden age of illustration, and then start dealing with color traditionally with oil glazes.
Yeah, no, it's No, that's exactly what it was, because that's essentially how I painted in oils before I worked digitally. And me not necessarily knowing any better, when I just picked up digital tools, just assumed that everybody painted the same way.
Right.
And now, I see these guys that do concept work and just kind of open up a canvas and just start painting directly on the canvas and then adjust as they go. And it's such a foreign, it's almost like an alla prima sort of method of painting, but painting digitally, which I definitely, I work a little bit better with the planned sort of structure of the thumbnails, then sketch, and then building up the values on the canvas, and then painting on top of that, and sort of using everything that came before to build the final image, instead of sort of just, I guess, spontaneously just start slapping paint down on the canvas to create the image.
I would imagine that you also spend the entire duration of building the artwork up to the point where you're ready to start working in color, actually thinking about color the entire time.
Sometimes no. Well, it depends. It depends on the piece, honestly. But in terms of, for the most part, no, not so much. Unless it's like marketing decisions of this book has to stay away from, you know, like we were talking about with the blues of the water and the destroyer and stuff. Unless I'm thinking along those lines, if it's kind of a one-off and it's like basically, you know, paint it whatever color you want, I might have a general idea that I think, all right, well, this paint is probably going to end up heading towards the greens or whatnot. But it's, I generally don't worry too much about color until I get down the road. That being said, I do also do some thumbnails in colors and show some color studies early on.
Right.
But I don't necessarily, I'm never really married to them. And I always try to sort of let the client know, like, look, I'm thinking along these lines, but things kind of tend to shift and adjust as I go. So, you know, I'd love to hear your opinion on color, but, you know, please, you know, there might be some shifting. And then if I see something shifting too much, I would certainly get back to the client and, you know, run it by and be like, hey, we, you know, originally I was thinking red, but I think blue would work better for this whole painting, you know, or something along those lines. So,
well, let's show those destroyer man covers then. So people can see that we were faced with four covers that had, they were naval battles. It was an interesting premise. These books have to deal with some time warp, and so we've got some sail ships as well as battleships all in the same compositions. So it and also dinosaurs as well as some lizard-like creatures. So there was a little bit of everything to keep everything interesting. He did a great job with the pacing of these and the storytelling. I know there's lots that we needed to cram into these covers, and I think that looking at your process with thumbnails, we see the value of those thumbnails and being able to consider all of the elements that are required and still keep everything kind of in a pleasing image that still needs to be placed on a book cover and share that space with text.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we approach, if I remember, it's been quite a while since we did the first one, but I think we approached the first one just by itself, even though we kind of knew it was heading towards a series. And then as I got deeper into the thumbnails, I think we started talking about the idea of the series. And then I think my thumbnails had three very, very rough color studies on them. And they weren't even really color studies. It was almost just, okay, this thumbnail's a red one, this one's a green one, this one's a blue one. And that was to get across the idea to you that I was thinking about, you know, almost marketing each cover with a palette.
Right.
And I think that's a good technique to use. I think it's it allows when you, especially from the first to the second cover, when you have two ships on the cover, it's tricky to make the covers relate yet still stand on their own. And I think color is a good tool to use for that. And I've not only done it with the Destroyer Man series, I've done it with other series I've worked on.
We're looking at the thumbnails from the first one, and you can see that they're almost like storyboards. There's such attention to the story itself here. You could almost, you know, see this frame by frame. Although you're giving us plenty of options, and you did give us possible rough color palettes for the first one, and I know we had conversations about how we could vary the cover. Not knowing at the time, I think if we look at the covers themselves, one of them, at least two of them are on land, and two of them are on the water. We didn't know that at the time, so we were thinking just color.
Sure. You know, it's funny when I haven't looked at those thumbnails in a long time, but I look at them and even when I send off now to clients, I send them off. My initial gut reaction is, oh man, I didn't do enough. Yeah. You know? So I always feel like I'm repeating the same things in them, and I wonder it's a balance of finding out for me, but also conveying the idea to the client as well, which I'm seeing a lot of them as being the same thing with just little tweaks. But I wonder how much of that gets across to the client.
This actually is, and they are quite small, but this is in my lecture slideshow, and I always get a good reaction from the crowd when they see this. I think most people would be terrified to do this many at such a preliminary stage, but they definitely get a reaction. I always get the question, does he send this many out to every job? And you already addressed that, that you don't do quite so many unless it's a client that you feel needs it.
Yeah, it depends on the gig.
So we're looking at color keys here. Is it just one that you choose that you think is working the best?
Yeah, I think.
Are you trying to persuade the art director by putting color on the sketch that you like the most, hoping that that's the one that they pick?
Oh yeah, for certain. Not in a sort of tricky kind of way, but just I would send the email off saying, I think number six would work the best, and then I would go and colorize that one. A couple of things there. I do like doing that because it, for one, I think clients like to see it, which again, I kind of fell into doing it for myself to sort of figure out color a little bit. And then I said, what the heck, when I'm doing this work, I might as well show it to the client. I think it's just another step towards helping not only the art director, but of course, editorial or whoever you have to run things by. It's just another step in helping them see the final product. And the sooner the sooner you can do that, the better, I think, for everybody involved. In this case, I actually think I originally had an idea of doing this one red. I really wanted to hit the first cover with the red, which I forget our conversations. I don't know if it shifted or if there was a reason we didn't do it. We saved the red for the second one, and I thought it was a nice compliment to the first cover. And I essentially just used that color palette from the second example we have up on the screen now for the second cover.
I think it was a combination of story. I think editorial wanted us to save the red for a little later on.
Kind of like a follow-up.
Right.
1-2 punch type of thing, yeah.
So just more thumbs, and then... Let's see. So these are the thumbnails for each of the series. And I know that there was... if we're looking at these here, there were headdress considerations. Do we want the lizard with a headdress? What type of a headdress? We ended up putting a very traditional Native American headdress on him, then explore the story more. And that changed in the final, which we'll get a shot of the close-up of the final of each one a little later on. But you included some of this more of your process of color. So I think this is important for the people that were curious about how you work in color and how you color key things.
And it relates to what we were talking about as far as marketing each cover. For instance, when I do a painting that is basically a blue painting or a green painting or whatnot, sometimes it's for marketing. But I also enjoy paintings like that. I really enjoy paintings that are keyed. It's not to say every single painting of mine is like that, but a good number of them is. And one way I go about doing it, I don't do this method the whole time, the same way every single time, but one way I believe I did the third Destroyerman there was using a tool called a gamut mask tool. And if anybody's familiar with Gurney's work, he goes on about this quite a bit and talks about it to much, much more depth than I'm going to certainly get into here, but he uses this method, which is essentially having a color wheel, and then the bottom left circle is a great example of this, where you basically have your entire color wheel, and then you just block out certain areas of it, and you only use the colors that are in that triangle, for instance, in this case. And that triangle there is essentially the palette I used for the final cover of this one. And by not going out of that triangle, it forces your painting to essentially be keyed in a very harmonious palette.
So I guess this is why that having a good, strong value study or value underpainting is essential in working this way.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, I mean, I wouldn't even be able to start thinking along these lines until I have the lights and darks down on the piece. So
I know there are ways to determine, you know, you could go traditionally with a color wheel and mask out a gamut mask and work that way.
Yeah.
There are other tools, contemporary tools.
Yeah. So I learned about it from James Gurney's Color and Light, I think was the book that this is in, but also on his blog and certainly reading that second Dinotopia book, which he does it quite a bit in. I really enjoyed the palettes in that book. And I think actually, I could be wrong, but I think he actually mentioned this website on his blog as well. And it's cool because it's basically a digital version of that very traditional method of you know, mixing your colors traditionally in a very limited palette. So the website's livepaintinglessons.com, and it's basically just a little interactive color wheel, which you can play with, and you can slide the sliders around and move the shapes around. And then if you see on the middle right there of the different shapes, you select a certain shape and it gives you a different color palette and different color theory. So you can have triadic color schemes and monochromatic and things like that. And each different, complementary. And each different shape corresponds to the different color theory. And it's just a fun little, tool to use. But I found it really to be useful because, you know, I was always the kid who, you know, you give me every crayon, I'm going to use every crayon, and then it ends up being a mess. If you limit the crayons, so to speak, it really wrangles sort of, at least for me anyway, my color choices in, and it gives me sort of some guidelines to follow in sort of way. And I find it to be really pretty effective for what I do.
So next up is a series of photos that we'll just run through, but I know it's, for some reason, people love seeing the reference photos that are used in creating works of art. And I know that there have been exhibits up at the Rockwell Museum where there's photos next to the paintings, and there's lots of places online where you can see the original photos that Elfgren used before he did his pinup art. So I think these are great that you're sharing them with us.
I will say that there are not going to be any Elfgrens in these.
So, you know, again, this is you shooting yourself and friends and objects in order to get the reference shots needed in a variety of poses. Possibly you're shooting this just not knowing what's going to work in the final composition.
Well, I have a general idea with my thumbnails, but I'm not afraid to venture out of those. And I don't mind sketching, so to speak, with the camera. I find, I can usually find things that I wouldn't normally think about in the photo reference stage as well. So while I generally go about it trying to sort of really hit what I'm doing in the thumbnails, I kind of have, you know, like that, like these couple, they're not, you know, I didn't really end up using them too much or much out of them, but, sometimes you get lucky and you get some fun things, and it can really inform and make what you originally thought with a thumbnail better, to varying degrees. So this is a shot, it's a digital model, and I'll be honest, I had help with this. my significant other, Christina, she helped me get through with this one. I can do some things with SketchUp a little bit, but this one was done, I think, with, I could be completely wrong here, but I think it was Maya or another 3D program that she was playing around with at the time. And it's a relatively simple model, but she helped me sort of piece it together. And I really wanted to, you know, be looking at something for those mines that were in the water. So in addition to that, so these are the reference shots to the destroyer, the third cover, the blue cover.
Right.
So you can see anything from many different types of lizards I was looking at to models of the different ships and things like that, and certainly museum shots of rigging and tons and tons and tons of feathers and headdresses and certainly beach scenes.
It's amazing to see just how much reference is required for that one image.
Oh, and this is only that was only a small portion of it too.
And then besides all of this reference, then there are these reference shots that you took of yourself as the character.
Yeah.
So it's compiling all of this information.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You own those striped pants, huh?
Oh yeah, I've gotten my money. I've gotten my money's worth on those. I've used them in a few pieces. So here's again sort of same deal for the fourth cover. Again, tons of those last two covers were really all about the headdress, or not all about it, but a lot of it had to do with these headdresses. But then again, models of planes, ships, things like that. In the fourth cover, it was all planes. And then there was sketch up models of barrels that I would just rotate and look at for ellipses and things like that and so on. So, and then tons of shots of me doing silly things with oh man. And there's Christina. I had to throw one in there of her. While I didn't use it for too much detail, I was probably in this case just setting up some rough lighting to make sure I had the rough lighting when I got the model in. So, but I had to throw this one in there. And then this is for the model of the main figure. So he's great. He had awesome expressions and
yeah.
You know, I love when I get a model that can act. I mean, there's, you know.
So we're looking at the final covers now individually, and this way everybody can kind of see what was required to put this together. This one didn't have figures in it, and it was the first in the series. And then the second, and now I'm sure having looked at all of the reference, everybody can kind of see how that reference is being used. I know the author loved what we did, and that's always a plus.
Yeah, I always wonder what authors think, and sometimes I'm a little leery to reach out, but Taylor actually contacted me and sent me, you know, some nice words about it, and I kind of did a little bit of a sigh of relief, because I certainly know that genre, historical, that anything that has any historical sort of connection to it, the fans can certainly be rabid and be sticklers for details. So I hope I did everybody right by that.
The thing to mention with those books is that although it was fantasy and science fiction, and that there, it's following this this storyline that is alternate. It could be considered an alternate history or mm-hmm. fantastical history. The ships that were in both the battleship and the mass ship were real ships in history. So
mm-hmm.
there's a lot that needed to be accurate. Otherwise, like you said, the fans are all over that.
Sure. So this is a, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I was going to preface this by saying that you do all of this work, and the other side of illustration is self-promotion and what happens to the work after that. The the goal that I've always had is to create work that creates a great cover, but also provides a great piece of illustration for the illustrator. I never feel like the job is done right if the illustrator isn't taking that piece of work and including that in his portfolio in an attempt to get more work. For me, that's a complete job, that I've achieved a cover that appeals to both buyers and writers and editors and marketing, but also provides the illustrator with something that they can say, I can take this now and get more work.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think, I kind of go about it two ways. I think it's certainly obviously very important to do a great job for the client. But the other thing I always have in the back of my mind is not just that job I'm working on, or not just I guess the pay for that job, or pleasing just that client. It's about getting more bang for your buck, so to speak, and getting a little more life out of the piece. Because what I mean by that is I find that getting the next job from a piece is almost just as important as the job you're working on, if that makes sense. And if you finish a piece, I think, and okay, the client loves it, but you're not going to show it to anybody else. Okay, you pay your bills, you get paid for it. Sure, but I think to sustain, that sort of perpetual income, so on, you're getting so much more if you can create a piece that's not only pleasing the current client at hand, but gets you other work, gets another art director to look at and go, wow, I really love that the cover you did for so and so. I'd love you to do something similar, or something different for me. And I think that's if not equally as important, it's very darn close. So
I couldn't agree more. I include in my lecture that every job is a stepping stone in the path to your career. And yep. it you need to, just like you're going to be very careful about every step that you take when you're on a climb upwards and on a hike, you need to make sure that you're putting all that attention on every job, the same quality. So that way it should be a mark that you're trying to hit, that you're going to end up with a portfolio piece. And I know that every job is different. And I know that certain, there are times that a client asks you to do something on a job that you don't agree with 100%, but they're the client and you have to get it done. But I think that it's a combination of making it work or getting something out of it that satisfies yourself, whether it's challenging yourself to learn how to do something better with every job that you take. So if it doesn't fall into your portfolio, it at least was something that you could strengthen yourself with.
And Absolutely.
So let's talk about what you've experienced as a result of the jobs and what you try to do to further yourself.
Okay. So, this initial shot is actually, I forget the order we have these last few in, at the end, but I think it's basically leading up to Spectrum, which has been a pretty darn big part of my promotion and just getting my name out there of recently. Not only Spectrum the annual, but Spectrum Live in Kansas City for the last few years. And this was from an article, I'm completely blanking on it now. Airbrush Action, actually. It's a magazine. It was a nice little write up on basically Spectrum. And it showcased myself and Christina, and as well as some other really, really killer artists that I'm huge fans of. It's all about getting the work, your work out in front of the eyeballs of other people who are going to ideally give you a call and ask you to to do another piece for them or whatnot. So yeah, so on the left is just my banner for Spectrum Live 3. So this is a couple years ago. And then here's shots of my booth with the four pieces, the four Destroyer Men covers up there. So as much as it's great to, you know, to create four covers and get compensated for them, you know, it's like I was saying, it's equally important for me to put these on the wall and be able to get a call from another client because they've seen them. And you know, I know some people that you know, do the work that they're getting paid for, and then they never show it to other people, and then get further work through portfolio pieces. Yeah, I mean, you can sort of do that, but I certainly try to double up whenever possible, as much as I can. And you know, like you said, not every job necessarily works out perfectly where you can do that. But I, at least for myself anyway, I really try to keep that in mind. So, oh, okay. So this is not only Spectrum, but there's other online. Well, this is an online, I guess, a competition that I just became familiar with in the last couple of years. Infected by Art, and it's a juried show. And I got, I think it was last year's Infected by Art. So I submitted these as well as 10 other images or so, somewhere in that range. And these were accepted into that. So
so is that then an online gallery that you become part of?
It is. There's an online gallery portion of it. And then I thought there was a published book as well, which they said they were going to send out a book, which I'm wondering where that is now. I don't know if that's changed or I honestly, I completely forgot about the book portion of it, but it's an annual. It's similar to a Spectrum or whatnot.
So far we're talking about exposure through articles. We're talking about competitions that you enter and expos that you would go to or shows.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And then, and then this was really kind of a highlight for me, and certainly the piece that got into this was really important to me for a number of reasons. First of all, when we were working on the piece, a little backstory here, before it even got to the Society of Illustrators for the Spectrum show, I know that third piece, when we got down to it, there was certainly some challenges. And And I think I don't think we butted heads on anything at all. But you know, we had a lot of discussion on whether it should go this way or that way, and this way and that way. And I'm so glad it went the way it did, instead of my original my original idea, which was I think I really thought we should be focusing on the boats for these pieces. And that was kind of out of my almost nearsighted view on it all. And I think you really pushed me, and I think the editor had something to do with it as well, was to, you know, no, let's focus on not only the villain, which is the lizard guy, but let's get out of this, you know, on the seas with the boats in the background sort of idea. And if you look back at the thumbnails that I showed, I had a lot with boats in the background, and I really liked them. And I thought, I thought the viewer was really looking for that, or the fan. And looking back now, I just look at it, and it really would have essentially just been the same cover over and over again.
Right.
And
I also think we were challenged with schedule-wise as well on this one. I think we were late to start on it.
Yeah.
And we were asking you to move out of what you felt comfortable doing and start researching lizards in depth and strange headdresses.
Yes, there was there were some stressful nights on this one, I remember. But long story short, it turned out well, and it turned out much better than I thought it would, and it really it surprised me in a lot of ways, and it got noticed by certainly some annuals and such, and got into Spectrum. But then it also got into the Spectrum show at the Society of Illustrators. So, I don't think it would have gotten in if I wasn't challenged with sort of the different things that you and certainly editorial brought to the table, and you guys really kind of pushed me to get out of my comfort zone, which was great, because I don't think it would have paid off if I didn't do that. So
I think personally, I was entering a phase in my career where I was looking to push and give challenges to illustrators and not just let them turn in the answer that was expected,
mm-hmm.
but to push them a little bit further, only because at that point I started to feel like, where else can I take this? How else can I,
sure.
can I try different things? And luckily whoever I've worked with was open to that, and it's worked out nicely. So another one.
I agree. All right, cool. So, and then, there's a shot of it on the Wallace Side of Illustrators next to some artists I really admire. So
right.
it was certainly an honor. So.
And then this happened.
Oh, okay. I forgot about this. I thought we were ending with the society, but so this was pretty funny. This was I got a call from, well, not a call, but I got an email. And I almost deleted the email because it came across, the subject matter was kind of, or I'm sorry, the subject line was very generic, and I almost deleted it thinking it was junk mail. And it was essentially an email from the, I forget her title now, but she works at Skywalker Ranch, the Lucasfilm library. And I think it's a certain division of it, like collections or something to that, something along those lines. And she basically said in the email that she sent, you know, she gave a little brief description of the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art, which will be, as long as everything goes all right in Chicago. I'm not sure what the current status is. I know there's some hiccups with it, but and it's George Lucas's museum on basically narrative art, art of the cinema, and then digital art, and how they influence each other and things like that. So it's a really great, it's going to be a really great collection of illustration, narrative art, and then things like for Star Wars, all the artwork that's involved in the movies and things like that. And then in the email they sent, I think George Lucas saw this piece in Exposé. So it was Exposé 10, I believe. And they wanted it on the website for an example of digital art. So,
and I think at the time that they requested it, it was when they were trying to convince San Francisco to accept their proposal for the museum's location at the Presidio.
Mm-hmm.
And so they put together a website to further explain what they were looking to create, what type of a museum. Your artwork has stayed there. And this one, I looked at the site today. It looks like that they're still, the plans are going forward for Chicago.
Yeah, I hope so. It looks to be kind of an illustration mecca.
Yeah.
So, I certainly hope so. So it was a huge honor. So I'm many fantasy sci-fi artists are fans of George Lucas, but it was definitely an honor to get that email. So
definitely.
And then this. This is actually kind of a funny story. It was for a gallery show in Philadelphia at the University of the Arts. And we were, myself and Christina brought our works up to hang, and we got there and they basically said, well, you have to hang your own work. And I wasn't up for that. I wasn't you know, about to install the show and things like that. So, and also it wasn't going to be easy. They wanted them hung in a certain way, so the work faced outward in the windows, and there was, it was really kind of complicated, and I just wasn't up for doing it. But we just got back from Spectrum, and I said, well, I've got, you know, we've got these really nice banners that we could, you know, hang in your window, and you know, I could kind of just quickly fasten them up top, and that would be good. And I'm sitting in the back of my mind thinking to myself, like, well, it's better that I even have this giant banner with my website and on basically prime advertising real estate in Center City, Philadelphia. And that was up for, oh man, it must have been 6 months. And I've gotten numerous emails from that banner, and just I it's such a weird sort of turn of events that what happened and where it was for so long, and it was pretty cool. So
that's funny. So the more magazine.
Yes. Imagine FX. I got an email from them asking. You know, they said they enjoyed my work, and this was right after I finished the Destroyer Men one, and I sent them in, and they put me in for an FXpose. The irony with this is, if you notice up top, FXpose, and it says traditional. and I still don't know 100% whether I fooled them, which I certainly wasn't trying to do, or if it was just I wonder if that category is more in the sense of, okay, we'll take digital work if it has a traditional feel.
Oh, could be.
And you know, that's one thing I try to get through on my work too, is to really give it a tactile feel. So, and then this is Expose 11. So the third Destroyer Man made it into that. Mm-hmm. Expose is a pretty cool annual.
So that image has had a lot of play.
Yes. Here's Expose 10 for the second cover. I've gotten quite a bit of exposure from not only that image, but just the all four covers that we worked on together have really been sort of received well, and I've gotten several calls for work from them, and it's just goes back to what we were talking about as far as extending the life of an image and getting the most out of it, and I think this is a perfect example of it. So this was for Spectrum 19, I believe. And that's the first cover in there. So.
I just wanted to remind everybody we're nearing the end of the slideshow, that if you have questions, that you can just put them in on the Q&A, and we'll open up the Q&A soon and address any questions that people might have.
And then there's both covers, the third and the second one, again in Spectrum 20. So,
I guess we did these pretty close. I don't remember what the timing was. I don't know if they were every 6 months.
Yeah, there were. It wasn't a huge amount of time with them, at least for the second and third ones. I think we waited for the fourth one for a while, but second and third one were kind of pretty darn close together.
I think this is the first time we're seeing the books with the type on it. Mm-hmm. And there we are at the Society. And I think that's the last one. Yes, it is. So stop the screen. All right. Okay, so thanks for sharing your process, and
sure.
I think the color portion was probably the question that most people had in somebody who does work traditionally,
mm-hmm.
in a very traditional manner, but in a digital space. And I know color is tricky whether you're working digitally or traditionally.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got a question here. Let me get it up. Sky is asking that you spoke about how you developed your value structure and color technique, but how did you discover and refine your very unique mark making method, and what is its function in the image?
My mark making was, I tell a lot of students this actually. One of the, you know, a lot of times people say, you know, oh, how, I need a style. How do I find a style? I don't have a style yet. And I think really, and I don't even necessarily it's a digital or traditional thing necessarily. I think it applies to really anything. And I think one of the best things you can do in terms of finding a style is make marks that you enjoy putting down, that are fun to put down. And once you start doing that, you start to refine them and tweak them and push them and pull them and find what you can do with that mark that you're enjoying putting down. And that kind of leads to a style, so to speak. And I think that's really kind of what happened with me. Was I was looking at a ton of, very bold brushstroke artists, whether it be N.C. Wyeth, Sal Tepper, Cornwell is probably one of my favorite in terms of brushwork, and certainly more contemporary, Greg Manchez. I just love I love the idea of putting down a mark and letting it go, and the biggest thing is that I enjoy making that mark each time I put it down, which really sort of encourages me to see what I can do with it, if that makes sense. So.
Yeah, I think a lot of people struggle with what their style is and the mark making. But mm-hmm. You know, for it to be something that's going to resonate with a viewer, it has to also come from a genuine source. So doing something that feels right and something that you enjoy doing is an extension of you. When you hold that, whether it's a digital application or you're holding that pencil, the way that you convey the thought, the way is just an extension of you. And so that
sure,
you can't fake that genuine aspect, and that's going to resonate with people, and it's going to be a lot more solid than somebody that's searching for a style and trying to find what that style should be or what is the trend in styles.
Oh yeah, I mean definitely. I mean, there's, well, I mean, then we're getting into a whole nother conversation. If you're right. Chasing a style, that's another. I agree with everything you're saying. I agree, and I think for me, it started with just, you know, finding that mark I put down, and I'm like, ooh, that was kind of fun. That was kind of cool. I like that. Now I want to do, you know, hundreds, thousands more of those, and so on. And then after each one, you're seeing what else you can do with it, and so on. So, but it's fun. I enjoy it. So
do you, was this digital, the mark making that you create in your work today, was this something that you found yourself doing when you were working traditional miles?
I did for, I mean, it's more developed now just because of my years of I've got a lot more years behind me now in terms of it. But for the most part, I was drawn towards the same type of work traditionally as I work digitally. And that's one thing, and I sort of touched upon it with Def Expose article about my digital work looking traditional. It's something I really strive for. And it's so cool when I hear somebody say, basically, you know, what, that's digital? Oh man, I thought that was, you know, oils or acrylics or whatnot, because I really put a lot of effort into giving the digital work a tactile feel, so to speak. And it's, you know, it's just the type of work I respond to. I mean, you know, all my influences that I showed you, and they're certainly not my only ones. I love plenty of digital guys out there. But I really think, you know, there's a ton of, there's some amazing digital artists out there I see, and I see them in the annuals every year that blow my mind in terms of their composition, drawing skills, lighting, color, whatever it may be, just storytelling, their drama. But the mark making is, I'm starting to see a lot of homogenous sort of imagery a lot of times in terms of the mark making. And that kind of is something that, well, it just doesn't interest me. I really enjoy works that have a unique mark to them. And I think that's just something I respond to. So therefore, I'm going to, I guess, sort of chase that, so to speak, with my own mark making. And as, like, you know, as powerful as these the digital tools are, they really are kind of limited in the sense that, you know, that different artists have their own voice, but a lot of the work still looks the same in a certain sense, and that's something I kind of want to avoid as much as possible for myself. It's nothing against anybody who works that way. It's just what I don't respond to myself. It's not, you know, so.
I'm not sure how much of the clarity in Dominick's images came across when we were looking at them, but it would be good for people to visit your site and look at some of the images so you could see exactly what we're talking about as far as the mark making and some of the finer details of the overall final look of the image.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a few more questions.
How much do I? Oh, okay, the thumbnail ones. Yeah. Thumbnailing. Honestly, it varies, and you know, it's sometimes it can be quick when my ideas come to me. And I get them down on paper, and I send them off. Sometimes it's a day, sometimes two. And I will say that's a rarity. Oftentimes it can take up to a week. And honestly, a lot of that week is sort of finding all the bad ideas and basically getting them out of my head before I hit on something. It's a lot of exploration. So a lot of the thumbnails we showed, those are the ones I would send the client. There's a ton of things that are kind of, there's a ton more that I don't even send. So it really varies, but it's anywhere from a couple of days if I really kind of get lucky. But even then, when I get lucky, I still keep doing more just to sort of make sure that I don't have a better idea back there. Generally a day to a week for my sketches. I think it's deceiving too, because I think by saying thumbnails and then you say, wait a minute, it takes you a week for thumbnails. Well, they are thumbnails, but they're figuring out a lot more. So as much as a week sounds like a lot, it's saving me so much time on the back end of the project. So
I think it's also that you're investing so much time and thought into those thumbnails, as opposed to someone who might be just getting down the basic areas, the composition, and worrying about some of the details and figuring everything out later on. You know, that's the other aspect of it.
Sure.
We've got another comment. Kimberly is asking, she arrived late. Kimberly, you can.
Oh, hey, Kim.
How's it going? Watch the entire broadcast will be available on YouTube. But she's asking, we did look at a lot of reference. Dominick was kind enough to share with us lots of photo references of himself in lots of different poses, wearing costuming, and strongly lit. She's asking about.
There's far too many shots of me doing embarrassing things in my living room for the sake of a painting.
She's asking about photo reference with the strong light source that gives that sculptural quality to figures in your work.
Yeah. I think that goes back to the very first slide we showed, which was. Those Brandywine guys, what did a lot of that have? It was a lot of deep, heavy, dramatic shadows. And I just really respond to that. Much like the heavy, brush marks, and thick, chunky sort of, mark making. I responded to their lighting as well. And there's some, just beautiful sort of dramatic shadows and lighting that these guys had, and I really try to strive for that, certainly in my own work. Which, as far as the reference end of that is concerned, you know, my reference rig is not that complicated. I know a lot of people have, you know, metered lights and things like that, and I don't use any of that. I mean, I have just a sort of two lights with tripods, and they're fairly powerful, but they're hot lights. They're constant lights. They're always on. I don't have it hooked up to any syncing sort of system or anything like that. And that's about it. So it's a pretty low tech setup. But I do usually strive for the heavy shadows, basically, and strong lighting. I really look for that because I just enjoy the dramatic nature of it.
Did you answer Tom's question earlier in full?
You know, I didn't actually. So Tom actually, I'm not sure if Tom's with us now. I know he asked it beforehand, but those of you guys that might not know, Tom's the author of a really awesome book series from Tor. And it's American Craftsman, which I showed you guys some of the thumbnails for. But it's like I said before, it's a little bit of a Tinker Tailor, Soldier Spy meets archaic magic, and a little bit of James Bond, a little bit of Call of Duty, a little bit of different things. And actually, it's much deeper than that too. It's a really pretty amazing series. So if you're not familiar, check it out. It's really awesome. But in regards to his question, what would you say that compared to other artists in the field, you put in more than usual time or effort in becoming familiar with your books, your book content for your covers? You know, it's hard to say because I honestly can only sort of speak for what I put into the covers. I mean, I've talked to other illustrators, and it probably seems to be about par for the course. The one thing I will say about that, though, is that it really depends on the book or the project, because some projects you have plenty of time to, you know, read the whole book, take notes, thoroughly research your subject matter, and so on, and spend plenty of time on this research. Other gigs you get, and it's you know, like the third cover we worked on, Matthew. It was here's the synopsis. We're thinking this scene. We need it pretty darn quick, and you don't have as much time to get in there and do the research that you'd want. I generally prefer the previous to the latter. I like to have a lot of time to really. Read as much as much as the material as I can, research it thoroughly, etc. But sometimes it's just you know, there's times I've also gotten covers where you know, the story's not even written yet, so they don't even have the manuscript to hand me, and they're just, you know, and it's a very quick brief, you know, oh, we need this ship with that, and we're thinking about some pirates here. What can you do? And then sometimes they'll tweak it down the road and so on. So, but you know,
do you ever have, interaction with authors as far as looking at, the work and guiding you?
For the most part, generally, no. Well, actually, no, that's not true, because I'm working on a series now for Audible where our author is the art director, so that kind of contradicts everything I'm going to say, and that's really great. But for the most part, I would say in general, at least, the classic method of working is that the art director and editorial would sort of be the liaison between the artist and the author. I think a lot of clients I work for probably run my images by the author. I will say with Tom, though, he was a bit of an exception, because the first cover went that way with Irene, and it was great. I don't want to speak for Tom, but I think he was pretty darn happy with it. But for the second one, when that came around, Irene sent me a summary, basically, and then And then I kind of reached out to Tom just to get a little elaboration on some things. And he was really super helpful with details and information and things that I didn't get in the text from that was originally sent. So it honestly just varies depending on the job. But for the most part, I would say I don't deal with the authors directly. But sometimes I'll hear from them after the fact, you know, such as Taylor for the Destroyer Men series. He sent me a really nice email. So
he was also nice enough to share our event tonight.
Thank you for that. Yeah, they're a lot of fun. I really enjoy that world. So I'd love to do more. So, but anyway. All right.
I think we've answered all the questions that have come in.
There was a ton of questions before. I wasn't really paying too close attention, but they kind of all disappeared at once. Is that
a lot of them were advice on echoing and sound issues. So I removed them since I wanted to make sure that we addressed everybody and that we didn't leave any questions.
Cool.
So I want to thank you for taking the time to have this conversation.
Thank you, and thanks everybody for tuning in too. So,
this was a lot of fun. I'm hoping that a lot of people got some sort of answers to issues that they may also be experiencing. We have one question that just came in.
You once brought in a digital painting you printed and mounted to oil paint over it. Is doing such a mixed media technique something you'd recommend for those who seek that traditional mark making? This has to be a former student, but I don't recognize the name. I think they're incognito. That's funny, actually. It's something I've been dying to do for a long time. I want to do one of my, and I never ended up taking that piece to completion, but I kind of bit off more than I could chew. I mounted this really gigantic 5-foot, 6-foot digital print onto Masonite, and I was going to paint over it. And because I was really kind of jonesing to get back into oils. And
was that a fully completed digital piece, or was it like you did some of the preliminary work digitally and then printed?
In that case, it was a full digital piece. It was actually it was a piece I did for Irene, and I wanted to really play with it and just see what I could do in terms of painting over, because I know there's some other artists that do it, and I'm really impressed with their work. Dave Seeley does an awesome job at it,
right.
And so on, and I still want to do that. It's just this one I probably should have started a little bit smaller, maybe more in a 2-foot, 3-foot range instead of the 6-foot range. But in terms of in regards to the question, is doing such a mixed media technique something you'd recommend for those who seek that traditional mark making? Absolutely. I think, experiment the heck out of it and see where it takes you. And kind of like what I was talking about before was, if you find yourself putting down the marks that you enjoy putting down, that always leads to something. Especially when you're a student. I mean, now's the time, you should be really going nuts experimenting, and then, paint over digital or paint digital over traditional and junk collage, throw textures in, or do whatever it takes to, break new ground. And certainly, I do think it would, help with traditional mark making. So
great. We are getting some last
hey Tara. What's next for you, Dom? Oh boy.
Cynthia Shepherd is asking, hey. after all your success, it's nice Cynthia's listening in. After all your success with annuals and shows, is there a next big goal you're striving towards? Do you have any personal goals? And Tara's asking the same thing. What's next for you, Dom?
Okay, well the next thing I can sort of answer a little bit quicker. I don't know if I can talk in detail about it, but I can say I'm working on a chapter book right now, and I don't want to say what it is or who it's for because I'm not really sure if I can talk yet. But what's cool about it is it's – Well, it's not technically my first chapter book. I did one many years ago, which, please, if you're out there, don't go Googling and looking for. I mean, this is back when I was like a year out of school. But it's kind of my first one that I'm working on where I feel like I can actually bring something to the table with it. And it's I'm really excited because...
you know everyone's Googling right now. You know that.
Yeah, I know. So, but what's cool about it for me is that, I mean, obviously I love all the Brandywine guys and all that, but, you know, back in college, for my senior thesis, I did, my senior thesis was, four covers for the, Wyeth Classics Illustrated. So I did, Robinson Crusoe, Michael Strogoff, Kidnapped, and the White Company were all my covers, senior year in college. And it's, I have all the Wyeth Classics Illustrated. I love those. I love the format. I love chapter books. I just think it's as much as I love doing the covers, I'm really looking forward to working on the chapter illustrations too. So,
what kind of time frame is that? When or do you have any idea?
I think next spring.
Okay.
And then in addition to that, I've got the covers I'm working on for Audible for a series, which that's been a lot of fun. And then I've got something tentatively planned. It's nothing's okayed yet. Again, there's not much I can talk about in terms of confirmation yet, but the chapter books confirm that I'm doing it. I just don't want to reveal what it is because I don't know if it's going to.
Understood.
As far as longer term goals, I don't know.
Is there personal work that you just haven't gotten to yet because you're busy?
Oh, well, okay. Yeah, I mean, I was thinking more in terms of things like, oh, I have to get into a show here or get this award or whatnot, which, no, I don't really think about that too much. I mean, it's always nice when to get recognized, but I mean, in terms of longer term goals, I'd really love to get back into the oils again and do that with the, whether it be integrating digital with oils or I'd love to be able to just go back and forth between the two. And that's kind of a long-term goal that I'd love to tackle. So, but anyway, hey, Tom is here.
Yeah,
cool.
Tom is here. And the question about the paint over was a former student, Melissa.
Oh, Melissa. Hello. How are you? So yes, former student. Thank you for the information. No problem. All right. Cool.
All right. So I think that just about does it unless, you know, we get more as we're trying to.
If there's anybody still listening, I mean, you can certainly shoot me an email if you have further questions. The other thing too is I have, which I forgot to mention, on my website, there's a video of my process. So instead of just a slideshow of the painting, it's beginning to end of the painting. Certainly welcome to check that out. And if anybody has any more questions, don't be afraid to holler.
Right. So. Well, thanks for taking those last bunch of questions for sitting and discussing all this.
Sure.
Pulling back the veil for your studio and showing us the way you work and totally appreciate it and thank you.
Sure. Thanks for having me.